Thank you very much. Could you give us an indication, please, of the likely program of building, both in terms of how many a year and the spread across the country? It's a massive infrastructure exercise, and whilst your objectives are marvelous, query, how will you fit into such a big building program?
Can you hear me? Oh, thank you. Hi, Natalie and Craig. Thanks for the presentation. My question was quite similar to the one before, actually, because last year it was indicated that some advanced HIP 2 projects might be brought forward to the HIP 1 cohort. And I understand that's what's happened to Manchester and Hillingdon, which I think were the other two you mentioned just now. So is it still the case that other schemes might be brought forward as well, or is the capital that pays for those schemes sort of locked in to the first eight on those other advanced HIP 2 trusts?
Good afternoon, can you hear me? Good. Well, I'll begin with an anecdote. When I was a registrar, they opened a brand new hospital called Derriford in Plymouth. And the hospital worked extremely well, but with one exception, they hadn't built a mortuary. And it proved to be very inconvenient. The patient continued to die. So that is a true anecdote, and it caused chaos. Some months. However, what I'm interested to know from both of you as experts in the field is what we've learned from the Nightingale Hospital as an episode in construction and the use of bombs at the Beaubourg or Pompidou Centre in Paris as a construction team.
Can you hear me? Hi. So I'm just wondering how the panel sees the integration of infection control measures, given that many of them are quite energy resource thirsty, and how they plan to model that in, given that there's going to be a change in how we look at the management of infection within healthcare going forward.
Yes, hello there. I'm Neil Carmichael. I'm chair of the Association of Dental Groups, so slightly away from hospitals, but I think important. My question is this: what consideration has been given to integration, both in terms of social care and, for example, dealing with chronic conditions, as you think about the design of hospitals? Because tomorrow's healthcare system, it's not just going to be about infection control and all of that, but it's going to have to think about public health and wider issues, obviously connected to social care as well.
Yep. Hello. I'm Bonnie from Waits Construction. So, Natalie, you outlined five key ambitions and challenges for the new hospital, such as MMC, standardisation, net zero carbon, which is great. So I guess my question is, would you be encouraging the trust with the hospital's new hospital solutions for those challenges?
Yes, good morning from tomorrow. I'm from the University of Western Australia. And Natalie, I was interested when you were discussing value for money, whether you're considering simply the value in terms of the minimum building cost or in terms of the cost-effective delivery of care. And my research has found that capital cost per patient is equivalent to between 5% and 25% of operating costs per patient. So saving in capital can have ongoing operational costs, as Craig was alluding. So I'm interested to understand, for the purposes of this task, whether you're interested in value for money from the point of view of the overall operating costs.
Hi, University College London. My impression is, as an observer, is that most of those hospitals which have managed to get themselves into the new hospital programme I just rather glad to be there, and in particular to have the cash commitment, and they don't necessarily want to hear very much about alternative ways of doing things. In other words, are these plans already rather too much frozen for something like the Wolfson Prize to have much impact on what's going on? Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name's David Sambach. I'm a freedom fighter in Shropshire. In other words, I'm a retired NHS chief executive. Bearing in mind what some of the panel have been saying, when we had the Nightingale wards, there was often a table where the people who could get out of bed could go and sit and dine with other people, i.e. other patients on the ward. Should we be bringing that back?
Alan Dilani from Sweden, Design and Health. Thank you for panelists. I think the future hospital should be based on the new vision and vision of how to promote health and how to keep people healthy. And that is the future task of hospital. And I think if we look that vision, the vision should be communicable diseases, lifestyle related diseases that has nothing to do with the modern top hospital. So we should learn from this mistake we have in many countries and look like countries like Singapore. They spend less money, they are top healthiest in the world. Why United Kingdom should not focus on the experience in the world and see how the rule of health promoting hospital and how we can deliver a vision that based on how to keep people healthy, to reduce non-communicable diseases. And that is the task of future.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I am a food strategist and I work with the London Collective. Really, really interesting thoughts and questions already around this topic. Bami said about some of the things at the Maggie Centre that make a difference and talk of a communal table. So, and also the feeling of being institutionalized when you go into a hospital. And I feel very strongly that food is a way of not feeling institutionalized, but having unfortunately been in hospital a few times, brilliantly looked after, the food does have a big role in recovery, in preventative, that into the discussions of a place for feeling healthy.
Hi there, thanks for a fascinating discussion. I've been working in the NHS and hospital and healthcare design for many years. I work for Guy's and St Thomas's NHS Trust. But I'm really putting a plea for, we've talked a lot about patient delivery by the bedside. I'm putting in a plea for mental health. And has anyone thought, are any hospitals in the health current program mental health? And different models of care.
Hi, can you hear me? Okay. Good. Right. Well, look, I put a question in the first group, and I think that revealed that very few lessons have been learned from building the acute COVID Nightingale hospital, which we have seen hardly used. But apart from that, I really want to ask the judges. Yes, sure. Is that better? Are they places where professionals practice, or indeed, are they part of the community? And I would like to float in front of you the concept, as in the Boberg Centre, that the institutions, the buildings, are bathrooms, which are then filled seasonally by clinicians and patients in varying exhibitions. And the important component here is that the structure is a open space, which is changeable and useful, and therefore what is important and might have been learned from the Nightingale Hospital is that the space is broad, serviced and changeable. And that's the point I want to make.
Yes, can you hear me? Great. Thank you for having me. Zig Rubel from California, United States. And just to build on Dr. Donnelly's response, I was curious about the role of research in the competition and the weight towards it, because the I often say that the only constant in healthcare is change. And how is this hospital of the
Hello, everyone. Thank you for all panelists. Alan Dilani from Sweden. I am public health scientist and architect, the founder of International Academy for Design and Health, working many years with Lord Nigel Crisp. And we travel worldwide, actually in South Africa, Singapore, Australia, and United States. And we discuss how we shift actually from the pathogenic approach of hospital now to salutogenic approach of hospital, how bring the task of health promotion to the hospital. And this is a crucial question that the pathogenic, the way to only cure diseases, also to add value, how to promote people's health and well-being. If I define the task of salutogenic hospital, how to deliver the most appropriate medical services for patients in very stimulating environment that support the healing process for patient, but also experienced by staff as an enjoyable and efficient workplace. And that is the crucial role of hospital nowadays in everywhere. But furthermore, how we can provide services that actively prevent people getting sick through diseases and identify risk factor, how change people's lifestyle. We pay 80% of the cost for lifestyle related diseases. And that is the task of the hospital, how to prevent that actually. And this must be deal in interdisciplinary approach, how to deal with local community, patient population, and application of holistic knowledge-based approach actually within the community. I think hospital must be changed as a traditional way. And that is really built so many PPP hospitals. None of them meet this requirement of the future, which means how to prevent diseases actively, how to promote people's health. And that is a salutogenic approach. We must change the health policy. And we have done in some countries, actually. In Singapore, we have done. In Australia, we have done some work. And in South Africa. Why we need hospital when the majority of disease is related to our lifestyle? So we can call lifestyle center, health promoting lifestyle center. We don't need doctor. We need health pilot. We need new education of people that working on hospital with different approach, not necessarily clinical, but really must be interdisciplinary and dilemma for many hospital in Western world, despite that spend a lot of money, but still we're dealing with curing diseases. How the jury give priority to this question and how to look for interdisciplinary approach to change paradigm from pathogenic to salutogenic. Thank you.
Yeah. So I was just wondering, would you be willing to accept submissions which focus mainly on mental health and like psychiatric care?
Hello, I was muted. I'm sorry. I didn't realize that. My name is David Allison. I'm a professor of architecture and architect at Clemson University in the United States that has been concerned with issues of the hospital of the future, I guess, for a long time. My question is, the hospital implies a kind of singular, is to what degree are you envisioning proposals that look at a constellation of settings that are systematically integrated of events and places and people that deliver services in the broadest definition of health and healthcare, and how open would you be to that, those kind of proposals?
Hi, good evening now. I'm from Cambridge. I'm an emergency physician, and I'm also a regional clinical advisor for NHS London. My question is very simple, relates to practicalities. Can I just confirm that the judges will accept a submission from a multidisciplinary panel that's made up organisations across the NHS, academia, as well as private commercial organisations? I said it was simple. Thank you.
David Stanbatch. This is my second question. I'm a freedom fighter in Shropshire, and I also used to be a chief executive in Shropshire. Can I ask the panel about hospital building notes? I don't know if the panel realise it, but the NHS have a set of hospital building notes. Many of them are about 10 years old. Would the panel agree that people shouldn't use the hospital building notes when thinking about hospitals of the future?